But for the first and only time in Australian history, that didn't happen. Instead, Carr sacked Whitlam. The democratically elected Prime Minister was turfed out by the Queen's representative. According to Pilger and Trento's CIA sources, Bill Colby and Maurice Oldfield discussed the matter, and our man Carr did what he was told to do. The dismissal, as it became known, is still recalled with astonishment in Australia. But from the British and American intelligence agencies' point of view, the outcome was exactly what they wanted. The Hope Commission didn't report until 1977, by which time Whitlam had been heavily defeated when he attempted to stand again, and Pine Gap remains a key asset of Western intelligence. Whitlam's parting shot was, "Well, may we say, God save the Queen, because nothing will save the Governor-General." It didn't bother the Governor-General too much. He completed his day by reinstating the national anthem. On the political level at home, Oldfield continued to have amicable relations with Ted Heath and Alec Douglas Hume, but felt equally comfortable with the Labour politicians. At the time, the mid-1970s, there wasn't, from Oldfield's point of view, an awful lot of difference between the two potential governments. The same preoccupations, Europe, the trade unions, the Cold War, the struggling economy, faced both parties, and the differences were more of emphasis than substance. Both parties operated so-called incomes policies as a means of trying to control inflation, were committed to membership of the EEC, and were trying, with limited success, to manage the unions. In terms of the EEC, Oldfield's work in providing intelligence to the government about the personalities, motivations and foibles of its European allies was important. His long-held strategy of finding ways of spying on those you really shouldn't spy on was used more than ever before in the run-up to British entry. The trade unions and the fears of their possible infiltration by the KGB were more of a matter for MI5.